Well, hello everyone. Welcome to today's webinar, the practical uses of Hadoop. My name is Tyler Wassel and I'm part of the Empower development team here at MRC. For those of you who are not familiar with MRC or with Empower, we are a software organization that has been in the application development and consulting business for over 30 years. Empower is our web application development platform used by organizations across industries to rapidly create web applications, reporting, BI, dashboards, mobile apps, and much more. Today's topic is obviously Hadoop and big data, and as I'm sure many of you are aware, these are enormous topics, and as such, it's not my goal today, nor would it be possible to teach you about the basics and the fundamentals of each in such a short amount of time. So instead, it's my intention to discuss with you how any type of organization may be able to leverage a technology like Hadoop to solve complex business problems. It's also my goal to get you thinking differently about how you can approach data collection and data analytics to hopefully gain a competitive edge in your business. So I'm going to start off by giving a very brief concept overview of Hadoop, what it does, and how it's different from a more traditional approach to data storage and analytics. I will show you a couple of practical examples of how Hadoop can be used to solve a few real-world business problems. I built some real-time Empower analytics and dashboards over a couple of live Hadoop data sets. Hopefully you will see how Empower can easily connect back to Hadoop to crunch and analyze Hadoop data. And after that, we will open it up for some questions. So what is Hadoop? At the highest level, Hadoop is a software framework for storing and processing massive amounts of data. To achieve this, Hadoop distributes both the data and the processing power across commodity hardware. Now, what does that mean? Commodity hardware really just means everyday, cheap, simple servers. Nothing fancy, nothing incredibly powerful. Using a traditional approach to data storage and data processing, as the data grows, larger storage devices are required, more powerful processors are needed to process the data, and large amounts of RAM are sometimes needed in order to pull the data into memory while it's processed. Hadoop takes a different approach. Hadoop distributes pieces of data across the available servers and also distributes the processing of that data across the servers. So in short, the Hadoop framework can take a number of computers and their available resources and turn them into sort of a supercomputer that all work as one. So what makes Hadoop different? Well, let's start out with the traditional data warehouse approach. This is really a paradigm shift in data warehousing and data analytics. Traditionally, we analyze our business and determine which questions we want to ask and answer. Questions like, what are my best-selling products? Who are our best customers? How much money did we make last year? And in order to answer these questions, we need data. Sometimes the data already exists for other reasons. For example, transactional purchase data. Your ERP contains a wealth of data that's generated just by operating your business. And this data can be used to answer some questions. To answer other important questions, we may create a data warehouse and try to capture that data that we believe to be important. This, however, requires a large upfront cost. It requires writing software that pulls in data and stores it in predefined tables. The questions must be known ahead of time. Often, if you want to know something new, this means writing new programs, creating new tables in a data warehouse to store the new data, and there's a huge cost associated with all of these activities. So here I have a traditional ETL diagram. ETL means extract, transform, and load. We determine what sources we want to pull data from. You might have transactional relational databases. You may have some log files or even some web services that you want to then pass through a data transformation process. And this is what we refer to as ETL. Finally, we load that transformed data into predefined structured data warehouse. Okay, so how is Hadoop different? Well, here we have a new ELT workflow made possible by Hadoop. Instead of ETL, it's ELT because Hadoop, or with Hadoop, we're able to take all of our data sources, extract and load them into Hadoop, and at this point, we're ready to analyze the data. We can transform it and store it right back into Hadoop. The results can then be queried directly by your favorite BI tool, whether that be Empower or something else, or even load it again into your data warehouse if that suits your needs best. So using Hadoop, we can capture all the data first and ask questions later. Traditionally, there's a price associated with storing data. If the data is viewed as having little value, it's most likely going to be discarded. With technology like Hadoop, the price associated with storing data is much lower, and as such, we're able to capture much more data. So what types of data am I referring to? This could be customer service and sentiment data, anything that might get logged over a help desk, machine data, whether it's machines on a shop floor if you're a manufacturing organization. It could be machines that you're actually selling if that's the nature of your business. Or we could look at web statistics. Sensor data, that's kind of the idea of the Internet of Things, social media, and of course any other transactional data. So the idea here is to capture as much data as possible from as many sources as possible, and then store that data into Hadoop. This is opposed to what we currently describe as the data warehouse. Really, this is more like a data lake. We're taking all the data in that we can. The value of this data is in its volume and in its ability to be combined and cross-referenced with other data sources. So with this type of data available, we can now start asking different types of questions. We can look at trends in buying behavior. We can look at customer preferences, trends in machine and equipment performance, trends in workforce performance, trends in customer sentiment, and correlations between business operations and customer behaviors. So with all of this data now available in our data lake, we can ask and answer new questions without having to create new software and data warehouse components. The data is already in Hadoop. Now we really just need a way to transform and analyze it. So looking at this slide here, I have a screenshot of a software server log. At first glance, it looks pretty cryptic. It looks random. It looks pretty unusable, maybe beyond really just troubleshooting software problems, which is typically what you're using a log file for. But if I look through this log a little more closely, I notice that there's a lot of useful information in it. It tells me which applications are being used, when they're being used, and by whom. So in order to get some useful insight out of this log file, all I really need is a way to transform it and a way to query it. Fortunately, Hadoop provides a number of relatively easy-to-use tools to analyze and transform unstructured data, like data in log files. So in my case, here I'm going to use, or I've used, two tools for Hadoop called Pig and Hive. Pig is a very high-level syntax, similar to SQL, that allows me to parse my log files. However, I need to, and then it uses something called Hive to store this transformed result in a schema. That schema is then queryable by a BI tool like Empower. I'm not going to go into too much detail about these tools. They're a little bit out of the scope of this presentation, but I can say that in a matter of hours, you can learn the basics of Pig and Hive and then create some basic transformation processes. Okay, so now I've loaded my data into Hadoop. I've crunched my log file into something queryable by Empower using Hadoop using Pig and Hive, and now I'm able to build some nice visualizations. So here I have an Empower dashboard built with Empower with several applications that queried the log file that I just showed you. This log was taken from an Empower cloud server where many people are building and running Empower applications. So the first visual that I have here is a line chart. It tells me how many applications are run each hour. I can see clearly that 9 a.m. is the busiest peak time on the server for people running applications. Below that, I have a similar chart that shows me during which hour most application development is occurring on the server. Now, For my network team, this information might be useful for understanding peak usage when considering what types of computer resources are needed on my servers and when. From a business perspective, it tells me how active my customers are in using my product and also how they might be using it. So if I switch to the 24-hour application popularity tab, they load, there they go. I have a few more applications that give me even more insight into my application usage. I'm not going to talk about all of them, but if we just look at the pie chart in the upper left corner here, most popular templates, I can see that my report with graph template is by far the most popular over some of the other types. And for those of you not too familiar with MPower, it's all template driven. So when you're building an application, you choose a template first based on what the application is meant to do. So a report template would do exactly what you think it would do. It generates a report. While the display and maintain rows template, for example, is really just used for maintaining data, adding, updating, deleting data, web forms, things like that. So this pie chart tells me that perhaps most of my development efforts, maybe I should focus them on the report template, and maybe that will boost customer satisfaction since they're mostly using that template. However, maybe my marketing team should ensure that our customers really understand what they could be doing with some of the other templates. Perhaps the low utilization of the other templates is simply due to a lack of promotion or knowledge of the other templates. So these are rather simple examples, but remember, all of this information came from a log file that I was already generating and not really using. All I had to do was apply the technology, and all of a sudden I have really instant insight into my business that maybe I didn't have before. So I have another example here for you. And again, we're analyzing some log data, but this time this data is generated by machinery. This is sample data from a great Hadoop tutorial from a company called Hortonworks. Hortonworks is a software company that actively develops and supports the open source Hadoop project. They have a number of great tutorials and other resources to help people get started with using Hadoop and other advanced resources as well. So if you're interested in Hadoop, definitely check out Hortonworks. But anyway, the idea here is that we are an HVAC supply company and we are selling heating and air conditioning systems for large buildings all over the world. The log file contains data that's generated by my HVAC systems in real time, and it's sent back to my company where it's then stored in my Hadoop system. So again, looking at this sample log, it looks a bit cryptic, but each line is a report from a particular HVAC system at a particular time. It states the date, time, actual temperature, and target temperature in the building. Each line of data really isn't all that helpful, but if I can aggregate and crunch this data, it may tell me a lot about which products are performing the best, in what buildings, and in which countries. So because this particular log was already in a CSV format, I really don't have to do too much transformation to it. Once I have this log data in my Hadoop instance, all I really have to do is load this into a Hive schema. Hive is what I was talking about before. It's one of the Hadoop components. And then once I have this Hive schema with my data inside of it, it's immediately queryable by MPower. So again, I have an MPower dashboard connecting to my Hadoop server, and I am querying this log file and squeezing really every bit of insight that I can from it. What I'm most concerned with here are the extreme temperatures extreme temperatures being any time that the building or the HVAC system is not able to actually address the temperature set by the user. So because my log data tells me that the target temp and the actual temp at a given time, I can crunch and aggregate this data into something meaningful using MPower. So in the upper left-hand corner, I have a chart that shows me the buildings with the most extreme temperature occurrences. To the right of that, I have a pie chart, and this shows me which countries that I'm operating in and which countries have the most extreme temperatures. Next on the right side, I have a column chart that shows me which type of HVAC systems are reporting the worst performance. And on the bottom, I have a line chart that shows me extreme temperature reports by hour. So there's a number of different actions that I can take as a business manager as a result of each of these charts. I can ask questions like, what is wrong with these buildings? Is it poor insulation, or is it a bad HVAC system? Maybe a different system would be better for these particular buildings. What's happening in these countries with the worst temperature extremes? Maybe it's something to do with climate in the region. Is it the building construction? Maybe the windows are open. I don't really know. Perhaps a poorly performing product needs to be redesigned or discontinued. So finally, I have a heat map. It shows me which countries my HVAC systems are performing the best and the worst. The green countries like the US and Mexico, Brazil, they're all looking pretty good. But you can see that like France and Finland, China, Indonesia, yellow and the red countries, they're reporting the most temperature extremes, and maybe more attention needs to be given to these areas. So using MPower and Hadoop, I was quickly able to go from unstructured log data that may have been going unused really to a full dashboard visualization in a really short amount of time. If you want to take a look at these dashboards yourself, feel free to use these links shown on this slide here. We will be sending out this PowerPoint to you in an email following the presentation, so no need to write them down for now. I just want to mention, if you'd like to learn more about Hadoop, we're planning a joint webinar with Splice Machine within the next couple of months. We've recently partnered with Splice Machine. They have created the only Hadoop relational database management system. So stay tuned to our event calendar on our site and via our blog. We'll post details about this webinar pretty soon. It's going to be a good one. Also, feel free to check out the Splice Machine website. So I hope this presentation was helpful in demonstrating how Hadoop is really different from a data analysis perspective, how it might be able to help you ask and answer different types of questions and make your business really more successful. So if you have any questions, please go ahead and chat them to me now. Otherwise, if you think of anything else you'd like to ask later, feel free to email me. You can see my email address here in the last slide. It's tylerw@mrc-productivity.com. Okay, so I have a question here. How much effort does it take to make data in Hadoop into a queryable format? It really depends on what the raw data looks like. The two examples I demonstrated today were very different in terms of transformation. It could take you less than an hour, and it could really take a couple of days, really just depending on what level of detail you want to get out of your raw data. In my case, I was able to take my software log and just do basic transformations to get it into the needed tabular format. And I knew that MPower would be able to do the rest of the heavy lifting when it came to only selecting data from the log file that was really pertinent to what I needed and what I wanted to analyze. So it really just depends on your application. Another question here is, how easily can you bring data into Hadoop? Well, Hadoop has a really large ecosystem of software frameworks, and there's really a number of ways to get data into Hadoop. It depends on what your data sources are. So, for example, there's a framework called Scoop, and that would allow you to move data from like one of your relational databases, whether it's an iSeries, a DB2, MS SQL, and that will move it into Hadoop for you. There's a framework called Flume, and that allows you to stream log files in real time into Hadoop. For more simple applications, you can even just upload files directly into Hadoop via a web interface. These frameworks, they do require some setup, but I found that the learning curve, for the most part, is not too steep. Okay, well, if that's all for now, I thank you all for attending, and have a great day.